To this evening on the identity and legacy of the Moors. He is a professor of history at West Virginia University. He is a contributor to the work, The Golden Age of the Moor. And without further ado, he'll come forth and speak to us. Thank you.
Okay, good evening. And Imhotep?
Yes.
Islam?
Yes.
All right. As the sister has stated, I am Jose Pimienta today. I'm a professor of history at West Virginia University. I was asked to come down this weekend and talk a little bit about the Moors, the identity and legacy of the Moors. Before I get started, I would just like to mention, as I do at times, if I seem low in energy, it's because, once again, I'm constantly on the go. It's been a long week, Million Man March. For one thing, on Monday, I don't know how many brothers were able to participate, but it was a powerful experience. And one of the lessons that came out of it for me was, again, the importance of knowing who we are and loving ourselves. And there's a connection between loving yourself and how much you know about yourself. So when the various speakers were up there talking about how we needed to come together, and when I would engage different brothers in the crowd, I found that those brothers who were the most receptive to the event were those who were the most informed about self, the ones who knew the most about who the African woman, who the African man are and represent in world history. Those who knew less about self were the ones that tended not to take it as seriously or came for different reasons. That was just my personal observation in being there. So I can't stress it enough, the importance of knowledge of self. One aspect of self is the Moors. We are the Moors. What I wanted to do was to begin by just pointing out how the legacy of the Moors has become obfuscated. And why? And then I'll get a little bit into the organization known as the Moor Science Temple at the end of this. One of the main things we need to understand is that history is designed to represent the perspective of the person writing the history. So if you're trying to get a sense of what occurred in the past, you have to look at history holistically. If I want to know something about the history of the Moors, I should not only go to sources written by Moors or Africans, but I should go to sources written by Europeans, strange as it may seem. I should go to sources written by Arabs. I'm trying to get a holistic representation of who these people are. When we think of the Moors today, there's this confusion about whether the Moors were in fact African peoples. Some people even who would consider themselves to be Africa-centered or Afrocentric, or even Diopian, who read Diop's work, The African Origin of Civilization, where Diop talks about the Moors as being recent arrivals in Africa, foreign invaders, whose genealogy actually places them originally in Yemen. Then, in the same book, when you read on further, Diop also says that Yemen was an Ethiopian colony. And that even the Arabian Peninsula was largely Negroid, quote unquote, right up to the time of the birth of the Arab prophet. Well, if that's the case, then if someone comes in from Yemen, are they a foreign invader? It would be tantamount to African Americans returning to Africa. Now, one could make the argument that your perspective and your experience would have been somewhat different because you were in a new area. But I don't think, at least I hope not, that people would say that you're no longer African because you've lived in the Americas for a certain amount of time, particularly when we know that there was a connection between the two areas. So that's important to state at the beginning. What I'm essentially saying is, even our own African scholars sometimes miss the mark. on identifying who the Moors are. I would submit that the reason was because that wasn't Diop's primary focus. He wasn't looking at the history of the Moors. He was primarily dealing with the history of Kemet. Knowing the brilliance of Diop, I'm certain that that was his attention. That was what he was focusing on. He too would have been clear as to who the Moors were. The other thing, of course, that creates problems is that the European world, knowing the legacy of the Moors, knowing how much of an impact the Moors had on their own culture, cannot accept the fact that the Moors are African people. To do so is to alter their own identity. One of my statements that I always say, and I'm at a university which is predominantly European American, I can count the number of sisters and brothers, African Americans, Africans in my class on one hand. And I have classes of 50 people. Knowing that when I finish my lectures on the Moors, that all those European students, many of whom are history majors, come to me afterwards and say, Dr. Bay, are you saying that I'm, you know, not me, but I mean, you know, white people are part Moorish? Because my name is, you know, my mother's name is Morrison. It's like they're scared. All of a sudden, it's like I just hit them in the bloodline. But I like doing that because it gets them to think about other, this concept of other. They don't see us as a part of their experience at all. They don't see us as having contributed to anything that's relevant to Europe. But when you start to bring out the legacy of the Moors, you also then begin to question what their own cultural foundations are. I tell you, the litmus test for me, in terms of people say, well, you know, when are we going to really live out, you know, the creed of democracy and brotherhood and sisterhood, right, in this country? When quote-unquote white folks walk up and openly say that they have African ancestry in their background, we know we've really arrived then, right, on a large scale. That's what I've always said. Well, it's happened 3 times in my lifetime. I've had 3 white folks come up to me in the presence of all these folks and say, I have Moorish ancestry, right after I had clarified who a Moor was. And you should have seen the other quote-unquote white folks look at them. They had just transmuted. They were no longer white folks. Right? They're no longer Europeans. Even though the name, this person's saying, my name is student just told me, day before yesterday. No, I'm sorry, Wednesday. Irish. She comes up and says, my great-grandmother's name was Coyle. And I said, yes, she says, and I thought you might like to know, I don't know if you knew this, Coyle means son of the black stranger. And she knew that they were Moors because I had talked about the Moorish presence and the significance between Ireland, the connection between Ireland and Moors and other African peoples coming into the area. So I said, ooh, something's happening. When you start getting Europeans to acknowledge that they're us, when many of us won't acknowledge that we're us. That's deep. But again, like I say, you have so much muck and mire to dig through. There's so much of a wall in front of the serious scholar, the historian, for she or he who's looking into the legacy of the Moors. You have to push so much stuff out of the way, we shouldn't be that surprised, right? And that's why, of course, the job of any academic should be to clarify that, and that's why I'm here. I don't know if that lamp is on. If not, if someone maybe could turn that on, I'd appreciate that. Thank you, brother. Okay. One of our dilemmas, when you talk about this issue of obfuscation in terms of identity, most European histories refer to the Moors as either being Arabs or Berbers. When they say Arab, they want us to imagine someone who has straight black hair, light in complexion, and could essentially pass as a so-called, as they used to say about 100 years ago, a Caucasian of Arab descent. Okay? So what they do is they stress one particular phenotype for what a Moor, and essentially this young woman here who could either be Arab or even quote-unquote Latino, if you will, is a Berber. She's a Berber. She's one of the indigenous peoples of what was now the country known as Morocco. The confusion that has largely been pushed by the European world, by European historians, is that Morocco is the only representation of a Moorish nation. In other words, Moors all came from Morocco. That's it. That little piece of nation today is the only place from which those known as Moors came from. That isn't true. That isn't true. But they also emphasize this phenotype as the standard. Now, that isn't to say that there aren't Moors who look like that. Of course there are. Just as you can look at the African-American community and see a range of complexion. But don't make her the standard. And if you do, you have to justify it. If she's then said, well, okay, well then show me that. Most Moors look like this young woman. But what we find is that that wasn't the case at all. Let me read you. It's good to go to old dictionaries, because dictionaries give an evaluation. I'm talking about 17th century dictionaries, which tell you essentially what people in Europe. Because now what I'm going to do is I'm going after Europeans now. I'm going after their obfuscation. A 1573 Dutch to French to Latin dictionary, okay, Dutch to French to Latin dictionary stated, Einen Moor is equal to un Moor, which is equal to Ethiops or Moors. Einen Moor is equal to un Moor, which is equal to Ethiops and Moors. Ethiops is Ethiopian, Moors is Moor, Einen Moor or un Moor, it's all the same. It goes on, or I go on actually to say now, and commenting on this, when the Dutch used the term Moor in the 16th century, it could comfortably be used as a reference to Africans from just about any part of the continent. Even as late as the 18th century, that was still true. A 1771 Dutch dictionary uses Moor and Moorian as a general reference for all Africans. This dictionary clearly infers that in the mind of the Dutch, those known as Negers and Ethiopians were merely branches of the Moors. They're all, in other words, they're saying they're all interconnected. Moor, Neger, Ethiopian, it's all the same. It stated that Negers, Ethiopians were only examples of Moor. I got that from Jack Forbes' work. Jack Forbes is a Native American and did a work called Africans and Native Americans, which came out about 3 years ago. And he talks about that. Let me then go on to finish. Forbes says that in the 16th century, the English and Scottish commonly referred to the people of Africa as Moors, and then later as Blackamoors, Ethiopians, and Negroes. See the digression? People used to use the term Moor, they used the term Ethiopian, they used the term, then they went to Blackamoor, okay, then they went to Negroes. So this idea of progressively making you a thing. And what I mean by that is, Negro is not an African word. The origin of the word Moor, and this is interesting, the origin of the word Moor, according to etymologists for the American Heritage Dictionary in 1978, the origin, they said, was African. Some people say that the origin is Greek, comes from Mavros or Moros. J.A. Rogers said in the 20s that it was African in origin. Now, he wasn't a linguist, but he was looking at linguistic evidence. Gerald Massey, the English scholar, the turn of the 20th century, also said the term Moor was African in origin. My money says that the term is African in origin, especially when even to this day in Morocco, the term for Morocco is Moraksa. There's that word again, Moor. You keep hearing that phonetic sound of Moor. But inevitably, as Europeans begin to lose, excuse me, as African peoples begin to lose power and Europeans begin to ascend in power, people have to begin to redesignate who these people are. So let me continue here. By the middle of the 17th century, the term Moor among the Dutch began to encompass Muslims in general. So now it's just a general term of Muslims. You're Turkish and Muslim, he's a Moor. You're Pakistani and a Muslim, he's a Moor. We'll just use it for all of you. The process of taking away the ethnic designation is underway. Swart began to be used more generally as a term for Moors, and as Forbes states, non-whites in general. That's among the Dutch. Forbes then states, by 1844 to 1845, Dutch dictionaries were reserving Moor for North Africans only. So in other words, the term before was understood to be synonymous with Ethiopian. It was synonymous with Neger, N-E-G-E-R. It was synonymous with African people throughout the continent. But by the middle of the 19th century, which also happens to be the same time that colonialism is beginning to initiate itself, particularly in North Africa, 1844 to 1845, the term Moor is now reserved for North Africans only. Anybody now who's in any other part of Africa is no longer considered to be Moorish. And anyone below the Sahara is a Negro. Again, a term which the Portuguese and the Spanish introduced to refer to those who were enslaved, those whose national status was not recognized. Because keep in mind, the Spanish and the Portuguese know what a Moor is, because the Moors were all throughout what becomes Spain and Portugal. Yet the Spanish and the Portuguese, when they travel to places like Mozambique and Sofala and Malindi and Mafia, these are places on the eastern coast of Africa, they called all those people Moors. So those people were clearly dark in complexion and typically Afrikoid. So they weren't reserving it for North Africans. But something happens later, like I say. Something happens, they begin to focus only on North Africans. That has to do essentially with the same reason why European scholars begin to deny that Egypt was African pretty much around the 19th century. After Napoleon has invaded and begun to take over the region, now he says, well, look, we got control of Egypt and we know the legacy of Egypt. We can't say that Egypt was connected to these people who are from the southern, who were from the southern part. If they could, they would have tried to move the North Africans out too and just say the Egyptians were Europeans. They couldn't do that. But the pigment differences allowed them to focus on the North Africans. Still with this idea of a hierarchy, as I sometimes refer to, this pigmentocracy being maintained. And the pigmentocracy required that now this young woman, going into the 20th century, has to be the standard for what a Moor represented. Let us move back then to see, as I say, what the visuals tell us historically. This is from the 1850s. This is the Sultan of Morocco. This was painted by a French painter. This is from the Image of the Black in Western Art, which is a very good collection to acquire. It's expensive. They always tend to do that, make the books that have the most to offer the most expensive. But here's the Sultan of Morocco with representatives from his guard. It's 1851. We jump back to the 13th century. This is Alfonso's chess book, or the chess book of Alfonso. Alfonso the X, also known as El Sabio, was a Catholic monarch who in the 13th century, after the Moors had invaded in the 8th century, understood that the only way for the Catholic Church to be able to subdue the influence of these Africans, these African Muslims primarily, the only way for him to subdue them was to begin to study their material, for him to embrace what the teachings were in the madrasas, or in the schools that the Moors had set up. because they couldn't compete. The Catholic powers at that time didn't have medical science on any significant level. So if you're trying to outdo your enemy, you have to begin to supply things to your people that are going to impress your people more than the enemy. If I can't offer up some people standing around saying, well, you want me to remain in the Catholic Church, my daughter was sick and I took her to one of these hakims, one of these doctors, and he knew what was wrong with her and helped her. What are you going to do? Well, you got to go take a walk to the shrine in Chartres in France and pray before the foreskin of Christ and you'll be all right. So I ain't got time to do all that. I'd rather go to this person over here who knows something on medical science and let him hook me up. Those issues were fought all the time. Yet people who were complaining about the fact that so many scholars, even in the church, kept going over to the Moorish teachings. So we can't even find a person who can write a decent letter in Latin because everybody's studying with these Moors. El Sabio, or the wise one, Alfonso X, monarch, understood that he had to begin to study Moorish teachings, make it available to the Catholics, thumb his nose at the Vatican, say, I don't care what you think, I'm here, I'm the one that has to try to run the show. We're going to absorb what is useful. That's the only way we can subdue these quote-unquote foreigners. But again, we have Moors sitting playing chess, they're dark, they got turbans on. A turban doesn't make somebody an Arab any more than a French suit makes you a Frenchman. And I could even go beyond it and say, with all due respect to Arab culture, who said that the turban belongs to the Arabs? People have been wrapping their heads for thousands of years. It's now something. That's another part of the smoke and mirrors of so many Eurocentric historians. Say that's Arab attire. The Africans are running around naked. They never had no sense, so they didn't wrap nothing on their heads. That's the concept they had. So when you see a culture of people sitting down wearing turbans and wearing white and so forth in this fashion, that's got to be somebody else. Can't be Africans. And we generally buy it. That's Arab attire. Somebody can wear my coat all year. It's still my coat. Unless I forget that it's my coat. This is from J.A. Rogers, Nature Knows No Color Line. And of course, J.A. Rogers is using the term Negro, right? Because he's writing in the 20s and 30s. But this just reiterates my point about the phonetic sound of Moor. All these coats of arms are coats of arms for European families. And the names are Morel, Morel, Moor, Moor, Morel, Moriel, Morel, Mormon, Maurice, Morcant, Moran, Mortison, Moreau, etc. So you keep hearing that phonetic sound, Moor, Moor. And in each one you see Africans. I don't see no Arabs, quote unquote, with the tip of meaning someone who looks like Omar Sharif or even someone who looked like the sister who I showed earlier. It was obvious that when they said Moor, they were talking about somebody who's dark in complexion and clearly African. That was the standard. These coats of arms are from the 14th century. Again, this is an earlier period. The Zangermeisters, or the Sing Masters. This was sent to me by a friend of mine who's actually German, Pennsylvania Dutch, from Lehigh County. He used to work at Lehigh County Historical Society, and you know, he knows that I'm the Moor man, if you will, and he was keeping his eyes open for me. He's one of these people, too, who has no problem in acknowledging African ancestry. He says he's a descendant of the Moravians, Moravian settlements that existed, and he suggests that those people living in that part of Germany had had contact with African peoples, and that's why they were referred to as the Moravians. So he recognized that at least as a probability, even though I couldn't put that out as definitive until I have documentation. But for someone at least recognize that as a probability, it's saying something. But he sent me this, the Zangermeister, the Singmaster family. On the opposite side was a descriptive of the family history, and it basically said that a Moor, der Moor, M-O-H-R, came to Berlin to teach music in the late part of the 1597. He came to teach music. He married a woman who was from the area. And this is their coat of arms. And he was known as the master singer, or the Sängermeister. But the significance, again, is there's evidence of a Moor living in Germany in the 1590s. There's more, again, this is from the same collection, Lehigh County. And again, in each case, there's nothing to be ashamed of. Nobody's standing there bound. If you ever look at some of the coats of arms for Sir John Hawkins, who was involved in the enslavement trade, he has Moors who were bound. Moors who were bound, meaning I was involved in the process of enslavement. And that was his coat of arms. So some coat of arms which have Moors in them indicate that the person was a slaver. But these are European families that have these in the coats of arms, and they're saying, look, person's wearing a crown. We have no problem in acknowledging the royalty of that person. We have no problem in acknowledging that these people had a profound influence and a positive influence on our own culture. Let's face it, I already mentioned Alfonso X. People like Michael Scott and Adelard of Bath and Peter Abelard and Erman Alemannus and Roger Bacon. These are all significant figures in European intellectual history who were known to have studied among the Moors or who were known to study from Moorish texts. And they were kind enough to leave the written word in Latin saying, I studied from the Moors. I studied from the Saracens. They identified their sources. In some cases, they did it out of honor. In some cases, they did it out of fear. Because it depended upon the Catholic Church's feeling about the period at a given time. Certain monarchs would allow you to do that. Others, if they found out you were studying Moorish treatises or medical texts, or philosophical texts, you could be vivisected, cut open in the middle of the square. You could be burned alive. In contrast, the Moors, in entering the Iberian Peninsula, what did they do? What was their attitude towards Christians? What was their attitude towards Jews? The attitude was that these people were still Ahlul Kitab, which means the people of the book, which means you're a Christian, you're Jewish, I'm Muslim. I don't see a difference because we're all following essentially the same code of ethics. We're all coming out of the tradition of prophets. We all recognize Ibrahim or Abraham. We all recognize, well, all Jewish men didn't recognize Jesus, but they were like, well, all right, that's your thing. Just follow what Moses said and we'll be straight. That's it. Do as he said and I'll do as Muhammad said and the Christian will do as Jesus. There will be no conflict. And it worked for a while. For foreigners to rule in a region for almost 800 years, that's pretty impressive. That's a longer period of rule than Greece and Rome combined. Ironically, of course, Greece and Rome get a greater emphasis in Western history, and there's no discussion of the Moors. That's why when I got to West Virginia, of course, some people in teaching Western Civ, they've never been the same. They can't teach the same thing anymore. They have to at least have a footnote on the Moors and then say, but you have to say, you have to take Dr. Bay's class, which is cool, because that's right. You come right over here and you get the rest of it. Before, they wouldn't do that. So something good came of it. This is a famous painting, which is in the Philadelphia Museum of Art. By André Charlemagne, it's called The Moorish Chief. And the Moorish Chief clearly is not a Caucasian-looking Arab. It was understood by this Austrian even as late as 1878. He's obviously visited this brother in his home, asked him if he would stand for a portrait. He did, and he painted him. Again, some people look at him and see an Arab. Because you've been told that if somebody wears this particular attire and has that type of tunic and a head covering, he's an Arab. But I'm still trying to figure out who told me that. And we know that this is a type of attire which goes back to the time of Jesus and earlier. This is the emperor of Morocco, Malay Ishmael. Says his mother was an unmixed, this is also from J.A. Rogers, whose mother was an unmixed Negro slave, had tens of thousands of white slaves. Something very significant about this individual. And it's, well, I should say this individual in this particular reference to tens of thousands of white slaves. The Moors were involved in the enslavement of Africans, and the Moors involved in the enslavement of Europeans. Slavery was an equal opportunity oppressor. If I had defeated you in a war, you were my captive and potentially my slave. If you were a debtor who owed me and you weren't paying me back, you were my slave. If you were a criminal and I caught you trying to steal from the granary, you would become a slave. If you were an orphan and you couldn't find family and somebody, all right, I'll take this, you know, the child, person had that type of attitude, said, well, you got to essentially be my servant. Not quite slave, but obviously a servant. You got to earn your keep here. These concepts, these historical facts are often overlooked. When people talk about the Moors and the involvement, Islam and its involvement in slavery, yes, unfortunately, everybody was involved in slavery. But let's ask another question. Was the form of slavery practiced by African peoples, even including African Muslims, the same as the form of slavery practiced by Europeans who professed to be Christians and superior? From a Moorish perspective, if somebody was a slave, it didn't mean anything. That's why people tell you they're a slave. My name is Abdul Walid. I'm the slave of Walid. So what's it to you? Even though I'm no longer the slave of Walid because now I'm free, but it's still part of my name. I have no problem saying that I'm a slave because it didn't carry a stigma. I was a servant of someone, but I'm free now. What's the big deal? You're going to hold that against me? Because the concept was that my labor was owned by that person, but I'm a man. And the system of enslavement never validated the notion of somebody being an object or chattel. Europeans developed the notion of the objectification of people and saying, you know, whether it was the Spanish or the Portuguese, said, yeah, don't even call them people. You're no longer moros, you're no longer African peoples. You are now piezas, your pieces. How many pieces you got on the ship? What's the cargo? And then English, what species of property we have? They wouldn't use terms referring to the people's ethnicity or identifying their nationality. But other systems of slavery under other societies said, look, unfortunate, we got in a war. I may not even like you very much, but the reality, I still got to acknowledge your humanity. That's part of my cosmology. I'd have to be out of my mind to somehow now try to argue you're not a human being because you were captured in war, you're now my servant. As much as I may hate you, I'm a fool. I'm denying my own cosmology by saying that you're no longer a human being. But some people can do it more easily than others according to the value system, evidently. Or I can objectify somebody to the point where, oh, you're not even a human. Species of property. If an African woman is raped, it's not rape, it's trespassing. You came onto my property. That's deep. Differences between systems of enslavement. That's why I don't back off as if, yeah, the Moors are involved in slavery. Dahomey became one of the greatest areas for trade and enslavement. It got rough up in there, as they say. But what were the differences between the institutions of enslavement in Europe among European Christians and Africans, whether they were African Muslims or Africans following traditional religious traditions like Yoruba or the Khan tradition? This is simply from the coat of arms of Charles Moore, who was a prominent barrister in England. And clearly, there's probably an embarrassment in England, I'm probably putting a Moor in his, or having a Moor scene in his quest. This is Johannes Mortis, who was one of the Moors who came during the Moorish or Saracen invasion into Sicily. He was the vizier of Sicily, one of the Sicilian rulers, Johannes Mortis. People often talk about the Italian community and say, you know, we know, you know, that the Italians have got some Moorish or some African ancestry. And there was a movie out. I'll clean it up since I'm on tape. But Dennis Hopper is tied to this seat, and he's being interrogated by the Sicilian mafiosa. And the guy's telling him, well, I want to know where your son is. And Dennis Hopper is defiant. He looks at him and he says, all right, I'll tell you where my son is. I want to tell you, where are you from? You're Sicilian, right? He says, I love history. I read that stuff all the time. He says, and I understand that these people, the Moors, these black people who came up into Sicily, and he said, and they, everything that moved. He said, and where there were people who were blonde hair and blue-eyed, he said, now I had dark complexion people with curly hair and dark eyes. And of course, then, you know, the Sicilian guy says, yeah. He says, isn't that right? And I says, yeah, that's right. And then he, of course, you know, shoots him in the head. But that popular movie slipped a little bit of historical information through. Some people caught that and said, oh, Hollywood. You know, not just Azeem the Moor in Robin Hood, but, you know, True Romance now is the film, I think, is making reference to the same thing. But Johannes Mortis. Now, fortunately, in Morocco, and in the official Moroccan tour book, this sister is identified as being a Berber, as well as the sister who we saw at the beginning, which means that anyone reading through or looking at the Moroccan tour book will say, wait, the Moroccans are trying to tell us something, aren't they? They don't say, this is a Negro woman, which you probably see in some European text. They said this is a Berber, a young Berber girl. But this young Berber girl doesn't look like the same Berber girl at the beginning. But yet they're both Berbers. And again, when you think of range, African American community, you've got range, which goes from the first sister to this sister and beyond. So they're actually saying, look, we know that we're not making any distinctions really based upon complexion. You're Berber. Significantly, however, the Berbers don't call themselves Berbers. Berbers don't call themselves Berbers. Berbers have names for themselves, which of course are related to their own language and their own experience. The term Berber is a foreign term as well. This sister is Haratani. There are other so-called Berber nations known as the Sanheja, the Zawata, the Lemtuna. All those folks, even according to European or Eurocentric scholars, are known as the descendants of the Moors. Those are the peoples that entered into the Iberian Peninsula. So basically, when you look closely and you see what they're saying this sister and everybody in between, on back the other sister, would qualify as descendants of the Moors. Because they're using the term Moor now instead of the word, they're using the term Berber now instead of the word Moor. They just abandoned Moor. They only talk about the Moors. They were in Spain, right? They were in Spain. They're now extinct. They no longer exist. That's exactly what people want you to presume. When in fact, the Moors are all around us. This is the same group. Look at the range. These are people all part of the same ethnic group. Look at them. You have the sister here in the front, a little bit lighter in complexion. You have the brother here. Everybody here is designated as an indigenous person within the southern part of Morocco. But leave it to Europeans to step in and say, well, nah. You know, actually, when I look at the Moor, the classic Moor, if you will, would be the person here in the front row. And the Negroes in the rear, of course, would be the slaves who were brought into the area following the invasion of the Moors in 1591 into Timbuktu. And of course, if we don't know any better, then we go, I guess. But when you start to look at the record, when you start to look back at the legacy, you know that people are blowing smoke and hoping that you won't try to brush it aside. When you are truly in the minority, you have to work tooth and nail, night and day, to be as divisive as possible of other peoples. That's why you hide behind a term like white, so that you no longer can have people thinking of themselves as Italians and English and Spanish and Portuguese and French, because if you do, they may still have some of those old, people say those old blood hatreds that are manifesting themselves throughout the world. English didn't like the Spanish too well. Spanish didn't like the English too well. Spanish called the English dogs. If you create a situation where people, we just hide behind this term white, we all identify, we just white people, right? And I'd see the white student union at Temple University come in and say, I think that white people should be proud of their achievements. And that's all I'm saying when I set up this organization. This guy is a white supremacist, came to talk to me in the department and let me know that he wasn't doing this because he hated black people. He drank with black people, he said. He said, I drink with black, I just go down to the bar and talk to this black guy all the time. We have a beer, you know. It's not, I don't hate black, I just for white people, you know. We have a lot to be proud of. I said, well, who are you talking about? White people. Who are you talking about? I said, what's your name? Spretzer. I said, Spretzer's German. Whose legacy are you grabbing? I read your flyer. You got references to Italians. Got references in here to Greeks. You've been grabbing up North Africa. Who are you talking about? If you hide behind the term white, nobody asks, break it down for me. Who are you talking about? Where do they go? The history of Western Europe is that long. You just got here. You just arrived in terms of knowing anything. But what do? You look for somebody, well, where are the lighter-skinned people who we can jump on their back and claim their stuff? Even though those lighter-skinned people are not part of your history. They're not part of your legacy. But you can hide behind them. Beautiful thing. Greek sister told this Englishman when he was English American, you and I are not related. She's Greek. She said, the Greek, what we were doing had nothing to do with what was going on in England. You weren't even close when we had it going on with Socrates and Plato and etc. And then, of course, I then had to say, well, where did you get the Plato and Socrates and Aristotle? And she wasn't afraid. She said, I said, let me ask you, sister. I said, and I did say, sister, at that point, I want to hear the rest. Where did the Greeks get it? Now, she's Greek from Greece. She's not a product of the United States of America. She's not a product of the U.S. So as a result, this is someone who would have been educated in Greece. She said, in Greece, it's not uncommon for people to say that we studied from the peoples in Egypt. Why would the greatest library, even of the Greeks, be in Egypt, in Alexandria? It's not in Athens. Why would they come to Africa and set up their greatest center of learning instead of setting it up in their own house? And of course, those who read the Greek classics, like Socrates, and who go over the writings of Pythagoras and others know that, and Herodotus and Olympiodorus and others, they say it. She knew it. She conceded it. And it wasn't hard to do. But again, we're talking about certain folks trying to continue to obfuscate the truth so that you don't see through the illusion. People say, will the real European stand up? Something to think about. And this is just a Moorish brother sitting in front of his shop. This was from National Geographic. 1989. This is a postcard. Sister got her baby on her back. This is in McNess. And I just put this in. This is also from the image of the black and Western art. That's the Queen of Sheba. It's the Queen of Sheba. And it's the Queen of Sheba as identified by the French. That's what they thought she looked like. And that's from the 13th century. That's a these are original paintings from the image of the black and Western art. I just put it in again. Point being, Europeans know who Africans know who the Moors are. But they're leaving it up to you to see how long you can remain ignorant of self. They know that self-knowledge will promote achievement. They know that self-knowledge will create a greater competitor. And as good business people, they're not interested in making you better competitors. It's that simple. I don't want to give you information of self that you know anything is possible. You can achieve anything you want. Anything that you will, literally, as in will, you can achieve. But if I can convince you that you're a black thing, you're a Negro who just popped up somewhere, like Topsy, somebody threw some seeds in Alabama, and people just came up, didn't know anything about the history of their past, then I'm good to go, because you'll always be. Essentially, a white Guérillon next to him. That's just an example of Moorish architecture from a palace in Marrakesh. And this is simply a page from a book, a medical text by Al-Zarawi. Now, Al-Zarawi was not Moorish. Al-Zarawi was actually Persian. But Al-Zarawi's books from Persia were being distributed throughout the Muslim world, and even among the Christians who would embrace the teachings without fear of being ostracized or excommunicated from the Catholic or Byzantine Church. So as a result, works such as this made their way into what the Moors called Andalusia. Spain and Portugal was called by the Moors Al-Andalus. That was the name given to the region. And this is one of the books, which shows not only how, on other pages, it shows the anatomy of the body, like if you had to perform the removal of kidney stones, or how to work on the eye, how to remove cataracts, for example. Not only would it show you the procedure, but it would show you the instruments to be used, and in some cases, how to forge the instruments, how to make them. Talk about comprehensive. I'm going to write a medical text. Not only am I going to show you how to perform the surgery, but I'm also going to tell you what instruments to use, and if you don't have them, well, you're going to need 5 parts of a lead, you're going to need 5 parts of silver, you're going to need, I'm going to go on and on giving you the metallurgical formula and the procedure to make it. That's talk about holistic, all in one. Europeans know this. Europeans know this. I'm talking about Europeans who are learned. Needless to say, if they didn't know it, if I couldn't prove it, I wouldn't be here. Like I had Europeans looking at me saying, well, I'm just basically shocked that you're able to find such information, Mr. Bay. Yeah. I said, well, I'm a little shocked myself. Thought you'd burned it all. Okay. So, having gone over that, let me just add a couple more things to give you some understanding of the significance of the Moorish legacy. I'll just kind of read through these, because this is something I just kind of added. This is food for thought, too. 13th century, the Moors under Catholic domination are officially labeled as Mudéjares and Moriscos. Okay. The reason why it begins in the 13th century is because The seat of Moorish power in Andalusia was at Córdoba. When the Moors begin to lose the seat, Córdoba, they really begin to lose a foothold in much of Andalusia. So that really begins the decline of the Moors. They're still there, and they, of course, are now focusing more and more their attention on Granada when they lose that in 1252. To then say to the Moors who are now under your jurisdiction, you're no longer Moors. We officially reclassify you. You're now Moriscos, which means little Moors. You're now Mudejares, which means the broken or tamed ones. You could ask the question, is that necessary? You won. You won the battle. We're here. What, let us essentially just exist and leave us alone. That's not good enough. We'll let you exist, but we're also going to reclassify you. I won't say anything further on that yet. Same century, 1268, civil legislation begins to urge ghettos, the ghettoization of the Moors. Now, that doesn't mean they put you in a slum, because people misunderstand what a ghetto is now, because so many ghettos are, of course, impoverished. A ghetto was simply a place where one group of people had to remain. It was like you were cloistered in a particular region. You have to live there. The so-called Jewish ghettos in places in Poland and in Germany. Well, there were Moorish ghettos in Andalusia. You have to stay there. By 1335, the church synods officially adopt the policy, meaning the whole church says, we like that idea, putting them all in one place. That's where they'll remain. We're going to make that a church rule. It's not just a civil law within individual cities. That's now universal, wherever the Catholic Church has jurisdiction. 1322 to 1465, Moorish surgeons, physicians, and pharmacists are prohibited from practicing. Take notice that 1322 to 1465, that's a while. That's 100 years plus of slowly saying you can no longer practice medicine, you can no longer be a pharmacist, you can no longer be in the medical field. That tells us, or it should tell us, what areas the Moors were in. If there were a handful of us there, we'd knock these five guys off and we're straight. But if you have all these people who are, we got to do this, we said we got to kill them slowly. We have to lull them. We can't afford to just go in and say you can't. We got to be careful. We got to legislate slowly away your power. Because if we jump at you too fast, you might still have a little bit of fight left in you. So we, just a little, over the course of time, as opposed to just somebody goes, I'm sorry, it was an accident. So it's slowly. But it tells us what areas the Moors were in. Tells us what they were focusing upon. 1412, Moors are denied mercantile enterprises. Means you can't be a merchant. Which means they were merchants before. Right? 1154, a Moor by the name of Al-Adrisi from Ceuta had produced a silver globe and a companion text for one of the Sicilian rulers, a man named Roger II. He's sometimes referred to as the baptized Sultan of the West, which is, if you understand that, people say that paradox. To be baptized and a Sultan doesn't make any sense. You can't be presumably a Christian and a Muslim at the same time. But this idea of saying this person was a Christian who was so enamored, so caught up in the Moorish way of life, Moorish teaching, that this person had to be referred to as a baptized Sultan because of that connection. But that book that was produced by Al-Adrisi was referred to as the Book of Roger. This book gave references to trade routes. It told the languages that Africans spoke in different areas. It told what products could be found. It was a beautiful text to be used for a merchant. If you were interested in mercantile enterprises and you're in Europe and essentially cloistered off from access to where the goodies are, I ask, What did Europe have in abundance? What did Europe have in abundance? And what made Europe great in terms of its products? What made Europe great was essentially what it was getting from other places, which it would simply take back and use as raw materials and then sell it to the same people who they had gotten it from. So what I'm saying is Europe's saying, we want to find some way to get access in there to get those spices, access in there to get those silks, access into Africa to get those foodstuffs. The Moors had introduced rice already into Spain and eventually to Western Europe. Sugar, cocoa, sweet potatoes or yams. People were going in to get food as well as, people say, things for in terms of textiles and so forth. And of course, who can forget, gold. So Europe knew that it had to use Africa as the proverbial cow to be milked. And unfortunately, here's a case where the Moors, kind of unwillingly, because of this information that they were conveying, knowledge, you know, I was put on the earth to share knowledge. I'm not going to hide the knowledge from you. You're an extension of me. I'm going to give you whatever I can to help and assist in this journey, make it a little bit easier. If I don't do it, something will happen to me. Not if I do it. But the attitude was among Europeans, look, knowledge is power. I know the trade routes. If I tell everybody, all y'all be up in here trying to go into Africa and get the goodies, and I won't make no money. I'm not really caught up in this thing called Catholicism. You realize that. It's just convenient. The same can be true for other people, religious traditions as well. But I know it's true for groups, people who are part of, say, the Venetian city-states. Those people wouldn't know Christianity to kick them in the butt. In terms of the followers, I'm talking about following the teachings of Christ. I should say that. They wouldn't know the teachings of Christ if it knocked them upside the head. Machiavellian concepts, the end justifies the means, social Darwinistic concepts before Darwin's even born. The idea that I'm stronger than you so I can take what you got. I don't give a hoot about some divine being. I'm with that Valhalla stuff. If I kill you in battle and taking your stuff, I'm going straight to paradise where I can kill more people. It's cool. That's the concept that is existing among many of the European peoples, not all of them. And I submit, you might, you know, say a lot of people, take a closer look at Ireland, because there's something else going on among the Celts. There's something else going on among the Celts. Which may be why people say that the Irish caught so much hell from the English historically, too. They saw some correlations going on there, historically. 1480, the Inquisition. The Spanish Inquisition, or the Catholic Inquisition, is established to oversee conversos and to eradicate heresies. Those Moors who are now Moriscos and Mudejars, who are within Catholic dominion, are told, all right, we think that you're a Catholic. You're telling us you're a Catholic. But Miguel says you're not. So we got to take you to court. And we're going to have to take your property to defray court costs, you understand. Even if you're found innocent, we still have to keep your property to defray court costs, you understand. And some of the Moors did understand, others didn't, and they jetted. Right? So you had some Moors who would leave and migrate to southern France, which, strange as it may seem, had rulers who were more amenable to the Moors than the people in Spain, in Catholic Spain. Meaning they were more kindly. The attitude was, we need y'all. You got something to offer. And they show up among groups of people like the Huguenots. And there are connections to the Cathars in southern France. And this is how some of these traditions end up as part of esoteric societies like the Freemasons. And show up as part of esoteric societies like the Rosicrucians, who will point to the Moors, point to Fez, point to Morocco, point to Muslims, and of course point to Egypt as the foundations of their teachings. But they got it from the Moors, who, as George James points out, were the custodians of Nile Valley civilization. See, all this information. That's why they don't want you stepping, don't think you're Moorish, because a whole world's going to open up when you start following up on the Moors and making the connection. Because you'll go to their study, they'll talk about the Moors, and they got you thinking and talking about some Arabs looking like Omar Sharif. But this idea of, like I said, defraying the court costs to oversee these conversos, of course, just another dig, right? You're innocent. I mean, you're guilty until proven innocent. 1547, the Limpieza de Sangre, or the Clean Blood Act, says that any person who's of Moorish ancestry cannot hold the church position, which means that you're being completely cut off from the power. You have no economic base, you have no political base, you're no longer allowed to speak the indigenous languages of Africa or Arabic, and both were spoken. You are no longer allowed, you can't even close your door to a Catholic Spaniard. Women cannot wear veils. People would make you drink wine in public, make you eat pork, and also tell you you couldn't dance, which suggests that Moors must have been dancing, which is not the concept that we have of Islam, right? Which is what I'm saying. African interpretations of Islam under the Moors wasn't the same thing. There is something known as Moorish Islam or Mara Buddhism or the Murids. Different interpretation of what that means. 1568, the Pope initiates an edict requiring that all Moorish children between 3 and 15 have to go to Catholic school. Now we're going to cut off your seed. We're going to make sure your kids come out hating your Moorish tukas. Because when they finish with us up in this Catholic school, you will think that you are the devil incarnate, and the only way you can find solace is to go to the bishop and kiss his hand and ask God to maybe turn you European in appearance. And of course the Moors figured it out, and so they gave one last push, and they had a revolt known as the Revolt of Alpujarra. Lasted 3 years, 1568 to 1571. Wasn't successful, and many of them found themselves, of course, being killed as a result. Granada had already fallen in 1492, earlier, I forgot to mention that, but Granada had fallen in 1492, which also opened up the Catholic kingdom and Spain to explore, to come to the Americas. And I dare say to come to the Americas using charts and skills that the Moors had given them. I don't believe for a minute that Columbus was lost. I don't believe it. I don't believe for 1 minute the man was not lost. He knew exactly where he was going, not only because Pedro Nino Alonso, a Morisco, was one of his navigators, was on board one of his ships, but also because Columbus conveniently did not bring someone who spoke Hindi. If you're going to India, bring someone who speaks Hindi. Why you got folks on the boat who are speaking Arabic, Chaldean, and Hebrew? Doesn't make any sense to me. And then, of course, if you read the works of Van Sertima, actually, it's not give credit where credit is due. It's in Van Sertima's edited work, but Kofi Wangara is one of the people, and a brother named Ramos are the ones that talk about the Carib Indians, who are really Africans. The term Indian and African was almost used synonymous. In fact, it was used synonymously at one time, which is what's so deep, because we still caught up, Indian has to look like the dime store Indian with the long black hair and aquiline nose and a copper red complexion. That's one phenotype of our sisters and brothers. But that wasn't the only one. There were Indians who were jet black in complexion, curly hair, walking around right here. But when you talk about the Indian cultures, we're still thinking of somebody who looked like Chief Joseph, but folks, Indians who looked like Lou Gossett. So when we, like I said, look at Columbus, and he came upon Indians and spoke to the king of Cuba, as he says in his diaries, the king of Cuba, and he says, we spoke to him right away. brought the guys forward who spoke Arabic, Hebrew, and Chaldean. And they start talking. How the hell are you going to start talking? You don't have anybody speaks the language. Come on, now there are no computers. We'll put in the format for how the language is broke down according to syntax and lexicon and the morphology, and we'll figure it out. No, they get off the boat and start talking. Oh, you, they said the Indians said they were people from the sky, right? And all these other references. Come on now. Columbus wasn't lost. 1609, Philip III orders the expulsion of 500,000 Moors. Okay? Which means that in 1609 there were still 500,000 Moors living in Spain, what's now Spain. 1492, when Ferdinand and Isabella unite the kingdoms of Aragon and Castile, they now have Catholic Spain. Something to consider here too in terms of the psychology, if you will, or the pathologies of different European peoples. The Spanish attitude towards Africans could not be as intensely anti-African as an Englishman. The reason was simple, because the Spanish knew that they have African ancestry. So they can't go there too far. They can't get into that area too deeply, because if they do, and you have any sense, they know you can squash them. Come on now. Come on, Julio. I know what's up. I mean, it's that simple. And my own father, coming from Cuba, and I was telling the sister coming over here, he came here in 1949, Cubans coming to New York, said, we're Afro-Cubans. They acknowledged their Africanity. Cubans coming in the 60s, they got a whole different agenda, because they're the ones who were kicked out because they were the white Cubans who had everything. And when they lost it, they're all upset. But the reality is, the people in Cuba know that Cuba is largely an African nation. And it goes back again to you know what the name of the oldest fortress is in Cuba? Anybody know? Moros Castle? The Castle of the Moors? Something to think about. So, what I'll do, I think I should probably stop there. I've spoken for about an hour. For any comments or questions, oh wait, let me say what I did promise to talk about something else. Let me say a few things about the significance of Noble Drew Ali. Noble Drew Ali is a man who was born in North Carolina in the 1880s, I think 1886. He's born in an area that's surrounded by a Cherokee reservation, if not on the reservation itself. He's said to have traveled throughout the United States, and I say he's said to because I'm not a specialist in the history of the Moorish Science Temple. All I can do is tell you essentially what I know, having had an opportunity to look at the record and what exists and think about it. By 1913, he's in Newark, New Jersey, and he establishes the Moorish teachings. He's in the process of establishing what will become the Moorish Holy Temple of Science, and then eventually the Moorish Science Temple. Why would this man in Simpson Buck County, North Carolina, begin to tell people in the United States who were going by the designates of Negro, Black, and Colored that they were Moors? Of all the things he could have chosen, why not say you all Ethiopians? Why not say you all Malians? Why not say you all are Zimbabweans? Why would he choose Moors? Right? That's a think of that. Very good question. The suggestion here is that he knew something about a Moorish connection to the Americas that even those in the Americas, particularly those in authority, could not deny. Benjamin Banneker was known to be an Ethiopian. People called Benjamin Banneker the Ethiopian. Thomas Jefferson, who hated, as far as we can tell, hated African peoples, turned around and said, that Ethiopian Benjamin Banneker, he's a pretty smart fella.
Yeah.
Right? So, I mean, he's He's qualifying him now, then. He's got all kinds of intelligence. Why didn't everybody just jump on that bandwagon? We're all Ethiopians. But he emphasized more. We shouldn't be surprised then when we find evidence that the United States had established a treaty with Morocco in 1786, which said that Moors would have the rights of white citizens. So for someone to know that in and of itself would tell somebody, wait a minute, I got a document here that says these people should not treat us this way if we identify and can establish ourselves as Moors. Treaty of 1786 turns out to be perpetual. It's still in force. It's never been not renewed. It was enforced 50 years after 1786, and then 50 years after that, and at that point it was just perpetual. We just leave it in place. Now, some people say, well, look, changing your name, saying you're now Moorish, isn't going to keep you from catching hell from this character. May be true, but what you need to do then is to look at the historical record and see if those who were designated as Moors were treated differently. And you know what? Yeah. Those who were designated as Moors were treated differently. Right. Another question we have to ask is, why would this man alter his behavior, meaning Europeans who were oppressive Europeans, all of a sudden decide now he's going to have a change of heart and treat these folks, because they call themselves Moors, better than these folks who are Negroes? Why would he do that? Is it possible that his value system told him he better do it? Did his cosmology tell him he better do it? Did something metaphysical or esoteric in his own belief system tell him he'd better do it? Because if he doesn't, he's violating the law. And the question is, what law? His law or some other law? Now let me back up, let me rewind a minute. I already talked about how Europeans in the southern part of France and other parts of Europe who had come into contact with the teachings of the Moors and then took those teachings to groups like the Masonic orders and different esoteric societies, including the Rosicrucians. What were they beginning to believe? What were they accepting that would begin to change their attitude in terms of how they would treat these folks who are calling themselves Moors? After they had written this document, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. And as Reverend Bevels would say, men is not a reference to a penis. Pardon my vernacular. It's not vernacular, actually, but pardon the comment. Men is a reference to that which is a reflection of God on earth, known as a human being. You can have a female man and a male man. Women are under that term. Those who have the male genitalia have commandeered this term and said men is a reference to me, but not there's a reference to you and her. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. If that's the case, then you better follow that creed. And if most of y'all were part of some Masonic tradition when you sat down and decided on this, do your own teachings reinforce what you just wrote? And yes, they do. Your own teachings say you should honor all men. Masonic teachings say all men are your brothers. So if you violate that law, who are you answering to? Food for thought. If we accept the premise, things that people like Steve Coakley, things that people like Anthony Browder, and others have pointed out with regard to the connection, and even Mustafa Ilamin, who's known for writing a couple of books on Freemasonry and African Americans and Islam and so forth and so on, Egypt. If we accept the premise that this country was influenced by Masonic principles, and as Farrakhan just said on Monday when he's talking about the obelisk and talking about the mirrored pools and talking about Lincoln Memorial and Thomas Jefferson Memorial, he's saying, look around you. and see that these folks set up a structure based on your principles. They're empowered by your energy. And you, most of us go to a church and throw our energy at some European. We're like batteries, and they're running off of us. So they just plug us in, and they're, let's hope they figure out that this is their energy we're running off of. But what happens when the battery jumps out, the boop, you know, well, I'm going to go over here. I'm going to do a Duracell, right? Like the bunny, and go over here and plug into my own folks. But as long as you have convinced yourself that God is a so-called white man, every day when we go in, we're throwing that energy at him. Take it. We don't see ourselves being connected. That's what I've said all the time. If someone is a Christian and they believe that Jesus Christ was God, that's a personal choice. That's not my dilemma. Dilemma is, he's not a European. At least put someone who looks like Nick Ashford up there so that you recognize that I'm throwing my energy back at my brother, and hopefully it'll come back. Yes. But there is a man is mine. Man is mine. If you're throwing your energy at someone else, he's taking it. He's not even saying thank you. So I wanted to say a little bit about that. Like I said, and I was talking to Sister earlier about the metaphysical references that I had made in another lecture, and I wanted to just add to that and close on this. The ancient Kemites understood the power of the spoken word. That's why they talked about nomo. That's why they talked about the power of words. Words have power. What power, what spiritual energy are we manifesting when we don't identify ourselves in accordance with who we are, but use another man's term, which was meant to refer to our objectification, our thingness, a black thing, something to think about. Thank you for your kind attention. Okay.
Question?
I will answer any questions if I can.
Before I ask you, some people believe that the Great Flood was about but when the flood came about, this continent was with Africa, and it was a mass of people, which all of them had one name called continent, ancient Egyptians or what have you. But when it divided, when it was all divided, some ended up here, some ended up over there, and it was impossible to bring all these slaves here because they was already here before this great white line. The question is, do you believe this, or is this possibly true? Or
I do believe that. I believe that a lot of us were enslaved where we stood.
Yeah.
We were enslaved right where we stood. I also believe that there was an enslavement trade because there's evidence of people being brought here. There are too many references to Africans being captured in Africa, even by Africans, to deny that there was no enslavement trade, right? But at the same time, there is also too much evidence of us having been here to suggest that we were not, in many cases, if not in most cases, perhaps, I can't say, enslaved where we stood. And again, how convenient then is it of identifying with something else and always feeling like strangers. Because if we always feel like strangers here, we really are saying we don't belong. Well, the reality is, and how many of us all, I mean, this is a pretty common, I think, most of us will talk about the Native American ancestry. Somebody got Native American ancestry. Everybody, right? My great-grandmother was almost everywhere, right? In the case of my own family, I just recently found out, the Pequot Indians and the Narragansett, who were defeated after what was known as the King Philip's War in Massachusetts, northeast, in the New England area. Many of them were then sold into slavery in Bermuda. And many of them ended up in slave ports in North Africa. African people were also purchasing Native American captives, as well as Europeans. That's why I said slavery was an equal opportunity oppressor. Africans were purchasing Native Americans as slaves. Native Americans, in cases also here, were taking Africans as slaves. So to me, it would be ridiculous to deny whether you're looking at the work of Alexander von Muthenau, Unexpected Faces in Ancient America, or R.A. Jaffervoy, or Michael Bradley, or, of course, Ivan Van Sertima. We know we were here. We know we were here. And wouldn't it be just a lot easier logistically for folks to just enslave you here than convince you that you came from someplace else, in every case, in every case. Like I said, I'm not denying that there was no enslavement trade that were capturing folks in Africa, because there's too much evidence to the contrary. But the issue is, it would have been a lot easier to just grab folks where they stood.
You had mentioned that most people are controlling them now by civilization. How does that fit in with Nubia?
Nubia was part of the same Nile civilization. Nubia and Egypt were essentially the same people.
Right.
They're all coming from out of the same area. They're all coming out of the Nile Valley region. You can actually contend that if you look at the conflict that arises between Nubia and Egypt, you know what the parallel is? I alluded to the one at the 1591, the Moors invaded Timbuktu.
Right.
Here we were kin before, now we're fighting.
Yeah. Here we were kin before, and now we're fighting each other. Now the other element, although I found out, the salt mines in Timbuktu have been taken over by Mali. So the Al-Mansur in the north wanted them back. So rather than just asking him and negotiating, saying, well, look, we want the salt, he just sent an army because now he had several arquebuses, which are were essentially guns, being a big gun, and brought them in. But then what happened to the people? They were absorbed into the population. So when you're looking at Nubia and Egypt, you're actually looking at a mirror, also the conflict in the northwestern part of Africa involving the Moorish Empire. But they're the same people.
Greetings.
Greetings.
Thank you for coming. I've often wondered just what was the meaning of all that the different forms in Washington, the pyramids, the obelisks, and all that, and you really clarify that.
The meaning?
Yes. Well, you know, the energy, as you just said. But what I also would like to know is the Moorish scientists today, what is their population? What are they doing? Do they have temples here? What is their impact on society? And also your name, you said there's Paul and Yanani.
Well, Mark is Pimienta Bay.
Pimienta Bay. Mm-hmm. Okay, can you
elaborate on that? Anil, right. Okay. The first reference you made was to the meaning of the symbols in Washington, for example, obelisk. The obelisk is often referred to as Cleopatra's needle. It's also referred to as belonging actually to Isis because it was Isis's reconstruction of the male member, if you will, of her husband, Osiris, after he was cut up into pieces by his evil brother Set. So she put them back together, but she couldn't find that, so she created this symbol. The other significance behind that is something that I really don't know if I can get into, because I'm not exactly sure how much deeper I can take that. I have my own ideas, but I've never really spoken to anyone in depth about anything beyond that piece of information. With regard to the mirrored pools, it's reflective of the mirrored pool in Egypt. With regard to the architecture, it's reflective of the temples at Luxor, in terms of the Lincoln Memorial and the Jefferson Memorial. You then asked me, what was the essence of my name?
Yeah,
Moorish Science Temple. Moorish Science Temple, in terms of the numbers, according to the Directory of African American Religious Bodies, they say that the Moorish Science Temple of America has about 6,000 members. The Moorish Science Temple Divine has about 26,000 members. One of the problems, if you wouldn't call it a problem, that exists is that the Moorish Science Temple under Nubal Draw Ali in the 1920s, everybody was under one jurisdiction. After his passing, there were then contentions for power, right? Who should succeed him? As a result, some people went with one person, some people went with another person. Those who went with one eventually created what would be known as a reincarnated movement or a divine movement. Those who went with the other would be part of the Temple of America movement. Then those groups would then fragment further. And you'd have people establishing the Moorish Orthodox Church. And you had other people establishing the Circle Seven Moors. And you had somebody else saying that they're part of the Moorish Brotherhood. So you had people then taking bits and pieces of it and going off in different directions. So you really can't say where anybody is in terms of the organization, in terms of counting numbers. It's that difficult because of the fragmentation. In terms of what they're doing, because there's so many, I can't tell you what all folks, I can only tell you what I'm doing. And I'm doing the best, and my own temple, and I'm from New York, and I'm part of 54, I am trying, of course, to share the information about the Moorish legacy with as many people as possible. But I'm not necessarily advertising for you to come to my temple. All I want people to do is to understand that you are Moors, that you are linked to the Moorish legacy. Now, what you do with that is up to you. But that in and of itself is empowering. And then the process, because it can then empower you to go and do historical research. It can empower you spiritually. I've actually said at times, what happens when people who will go and pray, and again, people fall on their knees and praying, and they see an image. Who are they going? Where's it going? When people imagine, prayer is powerful, but who is it going to? As opposed to saying, look, just like in traditional African religion, Yoruba and the Orishas, and the idea of calling your ancestors. You're acknowledging folks. If you acknowledge them, they'll acknowledge you. But if you're calling for Negroes, I'm dead black things. Come back and help me, please. Or people say, well, my grandmother recognizes me. Well, yeah, but you can even go beyond your grandmother and call out a term that refers to literally an army of energy. I mean, on that level, I'm saying that's the power of identifying with a nation, a recognized nation. In terms of, like I said, what people are doing, aside from myself, what Moors throughout the country, I've met Brother Hakeem Bey. I've never met the brother, but I understand he's quite knowledgeable, more knowledgeable, I think, than probably I with regard to the history of the Moorish Science Temple of America. He's written, he's given lectures, he's going around the country. In terms of what people should be doing, I think people should begin to follow up on just a little bit of information I had given about this reference to this treaty and its significance. One other thing, remembering that we live in a republic. And what does that mean? You know, we live in a republic. What does that mean politically? A republic has citizens, slaves, and aliens. Yeah. The question is, which are you? That hasn't changed. I'm just going in accordance with the political law. So if people are saying essentially that you should become a part of this organization because you can learn all kinds of neat things about yourself, that's a part of it. But what else is going on behind the scenes? And I just say again, is it possible that people who are in positions of power actually have to behave differently? We're not talking about rank and file Europeans, if you understand what I'm saying. It may not have helped you when you walk into a Klan rally by yourself. I'm a Moor. You know, what do we care? But I'm talking about the issue of those who are in political clout, those who are in positions of power, standing out front, following a credo. Say, I want to put these people over here, but I can only do that if this and this is correct. Came out a couple of years ago. Ronald Reagan was heavy into astrology. Came out after other people, but what's up? What's going on behind the scenes?
Right.
They don't want you to know that these are things that they embrace.
No.
They're convinced they're going to church, and you know they got this straight thing, and that's all it is. While we were going into churches, they were going into their lodges,
right,
and pursuing something different, and a different worldview.
Yeah, I'll go a little well there.
I'll come back.
I'll start going through history. What you're saying is real, because I'm not hearing anything about religion.
where it came from and how it actually affected them. But it's an experience that I had by myself and with my wife. But I won't go into the personal that you can find out for yourself, but there's a man who hands you data to manifest itself that out of this world, it really is. And but you have to identify yourself and who you truly are. Now you can probably go deeper into that than I could. He had me in the hospital by now to set my foundation. But far as the science is concerned, really truly need to find out who your divinity is part of being and more.
Okay, brother here? Sorry.
Basically, I guess maybe your opinion, what would you say was that caused us to, over the last few years or so, to stray away from what we once were, not try to hold on to it? As far as like, religion goes.
Right. What caused us to stray away was, I think it's part of our nature. Being in this. At some point, things catch up with us because we're still in this. So we're bound to some degree by what temple we occupy. That's why most civilizations, of course, at some point start to run out of steam, and then somebody has to be sent to begin to turn them back to say, well, look, you're forgetting your principles. It's, of course, quite honorable to suggest that we were able to, in the case of say Spain and or Andalusia, to hold on for almost 1,000 years. That's no easy feat. In terms of how we fell away, we essentially broke the basic brotherhood, the basic sisterhood that was in place, which was to recognize no matter what, we were all extensions of one another. Right. That's how simple it is. Everyone in this room is an extension of one another. And it sounds so simple to say, but it's often so hard to manifest. Because the ego, the individual self, often gets caught up in that. There's some element, of course, of us that is interested in survival, and that makes sense, because we as individuals have to survive, so we eat and sleep and so forth. But never should we forget that regardless of anything else, that we're interconnected. That was a basic kinetic principle, and what some people refer to as the concept of consubstantiation. All things are interconnected. Once we lost that, it was all downhill from there. Because then I said, well, I can do this over here, and it's not going to affect that brother. I don't care if it affects that sister. Mm-hmm. As opposed to saying, well, wait a minute. What is the ramifications of me doing? If I do this, how is that going to affect that? Right. A Khan tradition talks about the spider web. You hit one part of the spider, and Nancy and the spider, the whole web shakes. Native Americans, same type of cosmology. No surprise, because I just pointed out to you, they're us anyway.
Right.
You know? So, in terms of what we did, we forgot that. Something very significant, very powerful within the Moorish movement is its simplicity. And hear me, if you miss anything else, hear this point. The Moorish interpretation of Islam or of religious principles is simply that you follow 5 points. Love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. That's it. And if you go through life with that concept, whether you're part of a church or not is really moot. You're motivated by a spiritual principle which is bound to create unity. And if you fall away periodically, acknowledge you fell away from that, and always check yourself, always check ego. I don't mind when people critique me or go after me. It's cool. Because I may actually learn something from somebody coming down on me. I may have missed something. I got a blind side. But I'm committed to following those principles. So in terms of again, one, just to go back to the point Sister made earlier, if we're trying to correct the problem that we had, follow 5 basic principles. If you go and study the Marabout or Sufi traditions in Africa, you find that. People said simplicity. People are so caught up, oh, you got to do this and you got to, forget it. The spirit is within you. Doesn't mean it's where you cross like this or cross like that or how you don't pray right. What? Person praying right and doing wrong. It doesn't mean anything. What are your principles? What is your creed? What are you dominated by? Do you get up every morning and say, how little harm can I do to my brothers and sisters today? How little? I know I'm going to do some. I'm going to do some. How little harm can I do today? I don't want you to come to my church and put your money in my bucket. And then the reality is, I don't need that. I don't even, people say, well, but then you can't organize and pool money and resources. Yes, you can. It'll happen naturally. Because if you love each other and that connection, I don't even have, you don't have to be part of NAACP to get money.
No.
Yes, well, brother needs some money. Well, brother, well, hold on, I got something. Yeah. We want to do such and such. Well, I got, well, I can afford, well, I can't help, but give me a while, I'll see what I can do. That's what we're talking about. That's what the other forces can't control. They can control organizations. They can gang bust an organization and get up in there, and all kinds of agent provocateurs can take you off another direction. But if the people are like, I don't really have to put it here. I just have to put it here. I got to do something in the community. So that's my approach to dealing with that dilemma. Because like I said, I've met so many folks who, different sex and different positions, and then I start talking, and they turn me off because I am a member of Moore Science Temple.
Right.
They didn't hear anything I said after that. They're not interested in really making a change. They're interested in following their ritual.
Yeah. Got it.
And I'm not interested in ritual. I'm interested in spirituality.
So what
thank you. I'm sorry, brother. Love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice. And so I've heard some brothers and sisters say, in that order.
That's right, brother.
In that order.
Right. Just like that.
All right? I'm standing there, brother steps on my shoe. All right, brother, you step. Man, get out my face. But I just step. Love is operating.
That's right?
Right? Not justice.
That's right.
Justice is after he stepped on my shoe and then yelled, I should knock him out, right? But no love, huh? No, if not, in that order. So that's essentially what I'm dealing with. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Brother over here had his hand up, but I'll come back over here.
Do you know of any more in the United States that went to the World Court of Islam for the treaty and use this for atrocities that the United States has committed?
I don't. And I think there's a there was a brother out of Missouri named Jerry Lewis Bay.
That's right.
Who did something with regard to taking a group of Moorish Americans to Morocco and being greeted at the ministerial level. And that had ramifications too back politically at the World Court and other forces in the government. But I don't know anything beyond that. I don't know of anyone who's taken that, like you said, to the World Court. And I actually see some political and legal issues that would arise too over that issue of reparations. It's a little tricky. It's a little tricky. And people would have to have all their ducks in line before they took that step. And a lot of us can often, as they say, jump too fast before we've evaluated. So wait a minute, what are we dealing with exactly? So it's not a bad idea, but I'm just saying that's something that people would need to look at carefully before presenting that argument. If they were presenting it as Moors, that's the point I'm making. Okay, and then the brother back.
You have something about court?
Oh, no.
Okay, Brother Zay, what I wanted to ask you, I'm taking a course on survey of Englishmen, and we go over Charleston, Railroad, a lot of English classes that were dealing with more science, through the Knightley science.
Mm-hmm.
So my question is, what have you found through the Knightley Templars and their connection with the Baphomet and the Bat and other symbology that you see the sciences that they have built, and they're the carriers of the sciences for the Europeans?
I found the connection indirectly, but I haven't found, the only thing I can say when you mention the Knights Templar, I can give you the significance of the history of the Knights Templar, and then we can maybe look at the significance symbolically there. The Knights Templar was an esoteric group which was responsible, they were warrior priests who were responsible for going into Moorish territories and establishing treaties with the Moors. They later, in fact, would be accused of being too honorable in terms of their dealings with the Moors by the Catholic Church, and then later be accused of actually not being good Catholics, and the Catholic powers would subdue them and essentially, you know, have them murdered or dispensed with as much as possible, with the exception of, I think, one or two who were said to have escaped and carried the knowledge into other places. In terms of references to Chaucer, I haven't read Chaucer in about 11 years, so I can't comment on Chaucer. That's something which is not part of what I've looked at so far, so I can't say anything. If you know, or if you want to add something, I'd like to hear it. So.
I was just curious what you had to say about the Knights of Templar, and were they trained by Sufis, or what was the connection
there? Well, they were definitely, it could be argued that they were influenced by Sufis, because they fraternized among these Moors like it was nothing. And that's what created the problem for them with the Catholic Church. You could say that they were seen as kind of like this fellow Rogers II, kind of, you know, playing both sides of the fence and not really sure where their allegiance was. Another group known as the Mozarabs was similar. You know, the Mozarabs were Catholics who began to take on the accoutrements of Moorish culture and had their own interests. And when the Catholic Church needed them in some cases, they were like, sorry, we got our own agenda. So that seems to suggest that the Knights Templar would have been in the same situation, as would have been the Hospitallers, which were another group that existed in the medieval, quote unquote, medieval period, and had a similar task.
Okay, Brother Mark. You mentioned earlier that you thought, or that this is your position, that the people, those of us, our ancestors who were here, are Moors, and that we were enslaved here somehow.
Right.
Okay. My question is, I think historically we can see that the Moors had some motive for attempting to civilize the people, and that there was some conflict there. They did engage in barbaric type war.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If in the 1800s, 1700s, which is fairly recent history, the Moors here were in contention with Europeans, why did they not engage the Europeans in warfare?
In the 18th century, you're saying?
Well, 1800s, 1700s.
Can you ask me why?
Why were the Moors here subdued?
There were Moors here who were engaged in conflict with different European nations, especially the Spanish. Those Moors who were living in the Americas often would have aligned with the English against the Spanish. The Barbary pirates, so forth, that were on the high seas, were essentially at any European nation's whim, which again goes back to my point earlier about the fragmentation. Some Moors would align with the English to fight against the Spanish. Some Moors would align with the Spanish to fight against the English. And then when these United States is established, you have Moors in the Americas who now choose to align with the United States, thinking that the United States founding fathers or those in positions of power would have a different agenda, would treat them differently and give them access to power. So in terms of why they didn't, in terms of the issue of why they didn't fight Europeans, there were Moors that did and there were Moors that didn't. You can find references to treaties and laws where Moors who were in amity with various powers would be excluded from laws saying you can't do certain things. The fact that they would have to make that specific, say Moors in amity with, they were saying that there were Moors who weren't. And those Moors who weren't would often find themselves, I would argue, probably being pushed further and further into the interior of the Americas, probably aligning with Native Americans who had still maintained control of the various regions and fighting pitched battles all the way. But again, there were those Moors who found themselves in different situations and elected to take different, you know, courses of action.
Yeah, I heard you mention Moors in France and Spain and some places. What about you mentioned in the book, ancient modern Britain, were they also in
the British Isles? That's right.
Before the English, before the,
mm-hmm. Well, before the, certainly before the rise of England, England becomes England after the invasion of the Normans, right? And I think that's 11th century. And then the Magna Carta comes shortly afterwards. There were African people residing, or Moors residing in the British Isles, probably as early as Egypt, because there are references in the Scottish Chronicles, which is a 16th century text about the history of Scotland, which says that the people of Scotland had settled there from Egypt. Right, and talk about the kilt and even the style of music. I'll tell you straight up, I love most Celtic music. For something, it just does something to me. I mean, true Celt, when you hear it sounds like somebody, let's say a sister or brother singing, the trills and the up and down and the drumming and the rhythm, that's not English music. And that presence would, of course, be subdued over time as the Angles or the Saxons began to get control of the region. And I think, like when I mentioned before about the name Coyle, the son of the black stranger, that could be a legacy not of the Moors of the Islamic period, but the Moors of the of an earlier period, of the, people say BCE, which is indeed possible. So, and again, I think what I try to make clear is when you talk about the Moors as a definition of Moor, the best definition that I can give then for clarity is I don't put the Moors only within the context of Islam as in 8th century, or excuse me, I should say as in 7th century religious tradition. The Moors as a people have been here for, been on the earth since there have been people, since there's been earth, right? And if they entered into the British Isles calling themselves Moors, and then the Latins, meaning the Romans or the Greeks, were calling them Moros, essentially just added an os onto the end or an us onto the end, they were simply calling them by what they call themselves. Like I say, your reference, it's a good one, I'm glad you brought that up, the fact that there is clear evidence of a pre-Islamic Moorish presence, if you will, in the British Isles. And what simply happened was that those people were subdued. When I saw, anyone saw the movie Rob Roy?
Yeah.
Okay. And what's his name? I think his name was William Wallace, who was this hero, this national hero. I just wonder, this is just a question, I just wonder if when they start talking about these national leaders in that era, if we're not talking about people who would have looked more like you or I in those aisles at that time. I mean, it's something to consider, particularly when you look at the coats of arms and you see that the name Mac is a reference to the son of a Moor. That's right, Mac Douglas, Dughlash, behold the son of the black man. So the reality is we were everywhere. The only thing that, you know, creates some problems, of course, is some people still think of Moor within the context of Islam and the Arabs. So once you say Moorish, you, in most people's minds, you've confused them, because their reality of Moorish is only the people living in Spain and Portugal and in Morocco who are Muslims. And that's the battle that I'm fighting, to try to get people to understand that before there was the religion of Islam, there were Moors. And that, as I said, the religion, because Islam just means submission to the will of the Creator, has been here again as long as we have been here. And that's why the Moors, too, were generally the ones who historically were much more malleable with regard to their interpretation of Islam. And even to this day, if you come into contact with those who follow what's known as traditional Moorish interpretations of Islam, they're not well received by the orthodoxy in Morocco. They're seen as following an atavistic, meaning a primitive, form of religion. So, any other? Someone who has, but let me get somebody who hasn't asked a question yet. Okay. Everybody. It's not another name.
That question, comparing languages of Native Americans here and those natives Arabia?
I'm not a linguist, but I can just quote some references to what some linguists have said. In the 19th century, linguists were arguing that Native Americans were connected to the peoples of the Moorish Empire, the Arabs, and the Persians. And you had people who would write, if I can remember his name, McIntosh. John McIntosh, writing in the 1850s, made the connection between the two. Of course, Barry Fell, who is a linguist, who wrote the book on America, B.C., and Saga America, two books in Saga America, who is a linguist, pointed out the connections between the Arabic language or Arabic dialects and Native American dialects. I find it interesting that you find among the Cherokee, for example, many Arabic phrases. There was a sister who was a friend of mine who's from Morocco who visited a reservation. And when she finished talking to this family, this elder, she turned to leave and the elder said, Salam alaikum. And she said, Alaikum wa salam, and rolled her eyes and said, you speak Arabic? He said, no, I speak Cherokee. The fact that something like that would occur suggests that there is this correlation. Now, that could be indicative of an Islamic era migration, an Abu Bakari II migration, a 12th century migration. That's possible. But it's also possible that, you know, the Arabic language, which is actually related to Aramaic and Ge'ez and Amharic, which are Cushitic languages, are seen to be connected to people, again, of the African and Asiatic world. So I wouldn't be surprised if you would find connections between Native Americans here and those in the Arabian Peninsula as well. Islam, by the name.
Give us a correlation of the Israelites and present-day Mormons.
The Ishmaelites I can't say too much about, because I honestly don't know much about the Israelites. The Mormons, I can only say that some of their own former members have written books saying that there is a correlation between Islam and their teaching. I also find it very curious that they would say that the angel Mormon would bring down the Book of Mormon to them, and Mormon means Moor or African. And I find it interesting also that they would talk about the existence of African peoples in the ancient Americas. I also find it significant that they would have a hierarchy in terms of the heavens, what happens to you when you pass out of this flesh, that reflects elements of Moorish concepts of reincarnation and going on to the next level, going to school, going to another planet to manifest your or learn your next lesson, if you will. Those are some examples, like I say, of those connections. And of course, Joseph Smith is from upstate New York, which in the 1800s was a bastion of esoteric activity and which was still known to have connections to Native American traditions and African traditions. So that's about all I guess I could say. You're welcome, Brother Man. Okay. So, go ahead.
Any other questions? I don't know if I think Israelites have a connection with assassins. But anyway, my question was, have you seen anything that revealed that Moor has a nomadic reference based on the connection with Persians, Chaldeans, and the Tibetan connection and the Buddhist connection?
Mm-hmm.
I think you said, I think,
okay. I would say that it would be very easy to argue that the Moors were a nomadic people, given the fact that, like I said, we were in so many different places. Of course, we did settle. I mean, we would migrate, but we would settle, we would migrate, we would settle. So all I can say is, based on the historical record, I would argue that the Moors were also nomadic, which is why what a Moor is somewhat hard to pin down at times, because you find it in so many different places. People will try to say, like I said, Moors aren't Africans, because we find evidence of people known as Moors in Asia. Well, excuse me, but we were in Asia too. Canaan, for example, was an extension of Africa. We're so land-based now, in terms of we're focusing on the African continent, when much of the world, if not the whole, they can say the whole world was where we were. I just try to remind folks again, don't get caught up in our geographical locale so much as in the phenotype of the people, meaning the physical appearance. That's why I say Moor to me is a primarily Africoid people with primary cultural and historical connections to Africa and Asia. And then you could even extend that and say, well, to the Americas as well, but I just say particularly Africa and America.
I want to touch on the development of the new Dan Martin. And there's somebody in there.
Okay.
About a month ago, that a crazy man will brother right up here about the ninth temple. I met a real being in the ninth temple, some type of time career, I've got a lot of tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
But he was telling me, he said that me being a 30-30 degree Mason in a ninth temple, but your people, Americans, I wasn't trying to pretend you made that statement, but Americans, because I can't find a poor Afro-American, Negro-American, that would not be American. He said, there's going to be a tremendous change for your people. It's going to be fast and rapid. And he said that you must get yourself prepared for it. He said it's going on, and we talked, and he was doing stuff. He's an immigration attorney. He's an attorney to deal with people all over, deal with governments all over the world. I wanted to feed this into you so you can feed that to you. You can come and feed it. I'm going to exterminate it. I'm up in the house killing bugs. And bring me this to me.
Right.
Man, that blew me away. He was saying that. He was telling me this. And I turned around and I asked him, I said, well, what do you feel? Or what do you think this change is going to be? What's it not? He said, you people are going to come together so fast that they're locked into this political issue. If you're not here with me,
right. Can I ask you a question? Did he know you were a Moor?
I told him.
He told you you were Moor first, before he went into this?
No, I didn't. I turned around and I said, I said, let me ask you something. What do you know about the Moor? Because he speaks about five or six different languages. And it's quite he's from here, but from Switzerland and so on.
Mm-hmm.
And so I said, tell me about the Moor, man. I hear that he's a Moor, man. He was here before these slaves ever came in. Now he's all over the world, so forth, man. I'm just trying to.
But you said that.
Now, I'm saying this guy is, I'm saying, if he's real, he shaped his name with the Pope. His office is right here. I mean, I'm not saying there's lies to you folks. You know, he's been with all the most powerful people throughout the planet. And this is happening that this man lives in a huddle and drives a wagon, LTV. He's one of what we call fakers. But he probably was a powerhouse. But I pulled through him like that. He turned around and said, the Moors had the finest educational institution in Spain.
but they screwed it up once the god doggone Catholics ran in there. It all gets screwed up.
Mm-hmm. See, what he did obviously was just say, provide a kind of confession. But you can find confessions in the European literature in places that you might be surprised to find. But the thing is, we don't know where to look for them. We find Europeans confessing left and right, but we're convinced they're not talking about us because they didn't say anything about black folks. So when they make these confessions about the Moors, they make these confessions about Carthaginians, they make these confessions about Phoenicians, they make these confessions about Chemites or Egyptians or Libyans or various other groups, we think they're talking about somebody else. And right, and when you meet those, like I said, I gave a lecture, visiting professor, first, when I first came to WVU, somebody came up to me after the lecture, this woman is French, said I got Moorish ancestry. Just, it was a confession. She's in church. She just, in a Catholic church, given her confession in front of all these people. And then somebody else, when I gave a lecture in Missouri, stood up and said that his grandfather was African American, and he looked like, what's his name? Brad Pitt. And when he made that statement, right, when he made that statement, people again looked at him funny. But that's what happens when you illustrate your knowledge of self. No one can put, that's all they, and I'm not saying that's not what they're waiting for. They're not waiting really for us to get out. They would prefer that we stayed here because there are benefits in being a Negro to them. But then there are those who maybe, and I say maybe, there are those within the European elite who know certain things, who are perhaps of a different spirit, perhaps of a different heart, where they actually would like to see a change before the world goes completely to hell. Because they know that if, to some degree, if we don't wake up, the world is screwed. Because so much of the change is going to have to come from us. Because many Europeans are so motivated by they're so locked into a value system of materialism, they're not going to come out of that without coaxing. And if we just say, look, all right, that's it. You had your run. It was a nice run, but it's over. Yeah. Now it's time for the people who have some sense about how to engage the living earth. Let us take the helm again before you take us off into all kinds of things we can't even correct it anymore. But the thing is, we have to be straight and clear on our heads. And if we're still Negroes, and I dare say blacks, we won't have the proper education spiritually or mentally to be able to engage the new challenge. Right. See? That's what we're faced with. That's what we're faced with.
How does one begin to go back and trace their ancestors to see exactly? Because I mean, it's one thing to be the same as the Lord, not to be either, but
well, it is real. And I'll tell you why. You don't have to know exactly what part of the Moorish Empire any more than someone who was English needs to know what village they came from outside of Manchester, England. Mm-hmm. You, on two fronts. If you are arguing that your people came from Africa after having been captured during the enslavement trade, the chances of those people being within the boundaries of the Moorish Empire are very probable, okay? Which meant that even if you were an enslaved Moor who came here, you still fell within the boundaries of what would be accepted as the boundaries of the Moorish Empire. The boundaries of the Moorish Empire were recognized as extending as far south as the Senegal River. Consequently, anyone from within that region would be Moorish, at least. Now, in terms of what the specific ethnic name is, that's a harder issue. Because like you said, am I Wolof? I don't know. You know, am I Mandinka? That's a bit more difficult. In fact, if not impossible, because of the way that we were systematically broken here. But then there's a divine lesson there, perhaps. Maybe the point was to have us stop focusing on ethnic divisions and focus on a collective term that we could identify with, which still made sense. Okay, so in terms of you being Moorish, you're Moorish by virtue of that, and you're Moorish by virtue of if these lands were indeed, as we have historically and archaeologically been shown to have been the case, were under Moorish, or part of the Moorish dominions at some point, Moorish settlers, there's a second connection. It doesn't require you to be able to establish that you know what part of the Moorish Empire someone came from. And just forget the notion of coming from Morocco. That has nothing to do with being, well, little to do with being Moorish. Morocco is one parcel of what was once part of a larger imperial kingdom. And I use the analogy of Britain. Britain is made up of Scotland, Wales, and Ireland, and England. And of course, you're British if you come from anywhere within that region. So you're Moorish if you come from within a boundary which included that area. Now, again, some people are going to jump up and down and get upset when you tell them that because they think you're aligning to the Moors, these Arabs who are Muslims and Sunni Muslims who were only in Spain. And your only charge is to find out more essentially about how to defend your argument in terms of saying, no, no, no. The Moors occupy various regions and here's the evidence. Now, whether you accept it or not, meaning the other person who challenges you, it's not up to me to stand here and try to browbeat you. As long as you become convinced that that's a fact, that's all you need to worry about. But I'll say quickly, if you have a name which appears to be Moorish, then that could send up or should send up a flag in your mind saying, maybe that Moorish name didn't come the way I think it came. If you understand what I'm saying. A lot of us assume that the name came from the plantation owner or something. Maybe it didn't. That's a reasonable question to ask in light of what's occurred. You know, I keep finding references to Governor Moore or John Moore in 1703, and I'm going, now was this John Moore who took his name Moore from his nationality or took his name Moore as an inheritance from being a descendant of Moors in England? In other words, was the Moorish connection immediate or distant? Mm-hmm. So that might be, let's say, helpful if you have any you know name family names that might pinpoint a Moorish ancestry. So, okay, sister over here, and then I'll.
Yes. Right. And being a Moorish scientist, you said it's very simple. Aside from abiding by the principle, would you go to a temple or a structure? Do you have services? Do you have
the Moorish Science Temple does have what's known as a Moorish Quran or the Holy Quran, or the Circle 7 Quran, and something called the Quran Questions for Moorish Americans, also known as the Questionary. And then there's literature that pertains to the Moorish Science Temple that's a part of it. People are instructed how to pray, for example, in the Moorish tradition. But at the same time, people are also informed that there are different ways to pray. But again, some people want structure, and I understand that to a degree. Some people say, well, you know, show me, what do I do? I've actually told some folks, you know, when I was at WVU, I don't want to pressure people into following what I follow. That's not what it's about, because that generally is what throws people off. All I'm asking people to do is to think and to express certain things which I know to be true and to get them to reassess themselves. So I said to the sisters and the brothers who came, I said, if you offer a prayer, offer it up to the Father of Love. Offer it up to the Universal Creator. Offer it up to the Father, Mother, Spirit. In other words, you can convey the principle in words in any form or fashion you choose, as long as you're expressing as well as you can the principle. So to offer up prayer in that fashion, and in the Moorish tradition one also stands with one's hands out, which also happens to be the prayer stance of Isis, which is very significant, which also happens to be a prayer stance in general for the ancients of the Nile Valley. To do that, to offer up prayer from your heart, to literally say, I wanted to pause, you know, Father, Mother, Spirit of the universe, if you will, and the universe and the earth, to give thanks, or I submit, I give honor to all those ancestors who are worthy of honor. I mean, you can make up, essentially, your own prayer, as long as the Spirit is moving you to acknowledge your connection to that higher Spirit and to the universal force, to your ancestors, if you will. But if you want, as they say, structure, if one can find a Moorish science temple where they would be embraced, meaning people can come in and learn and say, I'm here as a student, I'd like to learn, there shouldn't be any pressure to do so. But again, the point I tried to emphasize before is, like churches, different temples have different personalities.
Right.
You understand, you know what I'm saying? Regardless of what people may be taught to do, folks don't always do it. So you can go to one temple and see folks, all kinds of chaos going on up in there. Oh my God, where am I? You can go to another place and see something which is, I think I just walked into a pocket of paradise. So you have to find out for yourself by, people say by seeking, but prior to that time, you can just begin the process through yourself. People say, but the risk of sounding cliche, it's all in you. You're armed with the knowledge, it's all in you. And then in terms of just serious, I came to my understanding of the Moorish Science Temple. I didn't go into Moorish Science Temple and then study the Moorish history. I studied Moorish history and then went into the Moorish Science Temple. And there was no pressure at the one that I was a part of. And my uncle was one of the people who was one of the chairperson. But nobody was saying, you got it. I said, I'd like to go to the temple with you this Friday. Okay, well, we'll leave in such and such a time. I went and sat and asked questions and talked, and oh, we went home. There was no hard sell. Just presenting the information. And then I found that I was offering information, too. I was critiquing. I was critiquing folk in the temple. They're saying this. Well, I'm a historian, you know. So I know. They ain't got no degrees. They didn't have any degrees from, you know, Temple or Cornell or from Gettysburg or Shippensburg University, but they sure had some knowledge and some degrees, right. So as a result, I had people say, I conceded and said, this is obviously something that is useful. But again, you know, it pains me a little bit to think that there is not one concrete place I can send folk to get some clear information. But at the same time, I know, as they say, it's all good once you've had the information, the desire to find the information planted. You'll find it. It's not a question. It's no longer a question of whether you'll find truth. You are destined to find truth. It just takes, some people may take a little longer than others, but you're going to be all right. That's the way I look at it. We're going to be all right.
I just want to say, and I don't know if that helps somebody else, that my background has been Catholic, Baptist, and, you know, I've run the gamut. However, even very early, when I saw the words King James Version, I was 6 years old in St. Mary's in Savannah, I thought,
that's right. That's right.
And I was the only Baptist, even though I went to the Catholic school, but when everybody went to confession, I was sitting at the nun and she was sitting looking at me. I was the only one left in class. But I thank the Creator for that ability to question, and for some reason I've always had to speak truth, and it's taken me on a journey, and like I wouldn't take anything for it. So I've come out of the big church where I was on the board of trustees and, you know, singing and whatnot, because I just was not being filled spiritually.
Right.
But I did believe that the Spirit moved me. And if you are speaking truth with all your heart and soul, it will move you and you will be on a journey.
That's right.
Not afraid to move. And I've always asked that I be guided and not leaning to my own understanding.
Mm-hmm.
Let the Spirit guide me. When you rest in that, you'll be able to discern what is true and what isn't.
Even with my Hebrew Israelite, even with my Baha'i friends, but they are none of them some total. That's right. But I've learned it from all of them, and I feel a sense of great freedom, and there's a universal truth that I'm learning through all of them. That's exactly right. But don't be afraid to speak, and I'm still speaking and learning, and I love it. And I know I'll get there. That's right. You're destined. And like I said, that's the Moorish position, is that universal thread.
Yes.
Every the Baha'i, basically believe that all religions have universal truth within them, and that's why they give honor and respect to all universal religions. They follow a Muslim who took, was at odds with the Shiite and Sunni tradition because he was giving honor to that principle a little too much. And as a result, he then would have a group which would create its own thing known as the Baha'i, the followers of the Baha'u'llah or the Bab. So we recognize that the fact of these principles, what we're supposed to be focusing on. That's what I said. I'll tell you the truth. I've gone to the AME church at times in my town. There are no Moorish temples where I live. Mm-hmm. I've gone to African Methodist Episcopal Church sometimes just to hear something uplifting spiritually. And I was able to do that until I was told that the minister didn't want Muslims coming to the church because we were bringing in our own spirits.
Yeah.
And that scared me. And I said, well, maybe I can kind of understand his point till I went downstairs to the rectory and saw Jesus of Norway instead of Jesus of Nazareth on the wall. And when I saw Jesus of Norway, I said, well, no, I don't think, maybe I was here because other people were giving the sermons. But once that came out, I said, I can't deal with this anymore. But my point being that I can feel comfortable anywhere where there's a spirit of love, truth, peace, freedom, and justice, and anywhere where we are, with those principles. With those principles. I don't care what anybody calls himself. I'm concerned about your creed. And you don't have to follow my ritual. Just follow the creed and, like I said, get up in the morning and say, how little harm can I do to my brothers and sisters today? How little, that's all. I know, like I said, I know something's going to happen, but when I do, let me check myself immediately and then go back and see if I can correct it.
Yes, ma'am. Would you please speak on Benjamin Banneker Bay?
Benjamin Banneker Bay. I can only tell you that Benjamin Banneker Bay, according to certain Moorish traditions, I think the Circle Seven Moors have established that Benjamin Banneker was definitely a Moor who was a Bey, who had the breadth of knowledge that he had because of, a typical Moorish education, to be able to produce a clock, to be able to have such skills in astronomy and mathematics. Was not a fluke. This was an educated man trained in the Moorish tradition. This is someone who was free, is known to have been free from Maryland, and that's the extent of my knowledge on Benjamin Banneker Bay.
Islam. When your travels, have you heard anything about the Battle of Lake Erie?
The Battle of Lake Erie. Is that also in reference to Battle Creek, Michigan? Or is that something different?
Yeah.
1812?
Yeah.
Okay. Connection to Tecumseh, right? Is that what you're talking about, or is that something else? Tecumseh, who was a Creek, who was also in Moorish American tradition, and I have to stress that, referred to as Tecumseh or Tecumseh Bay, whose brother was the prophet Tenskwatawa, who was trying to unite the indigenous peoples of this land against European encroachment into Indian territories, and who had tried to get people to go back to the traditional teachings and to reject the European emphasis on drinking and European ways of life, European interpretations of Christ, and basically fought the last pitched battle at Battle Creek, Michigan. And that was, according to Moorish American tradition, the year, I think it was 1812, 1813, when the flag, the last Moorish flag in these lands, went down. And then it would not be taken out again until Noble Drew Ali would get it from Washington. And that's part of Moorish American oral history. Unfortunately, to be able to affirm that with outside documentation has thus far been very difficult. And I submit that if anyone ever gets any information, primary source information, dealing with Tecumseh and the battle, please let me know. And that goes out to anyone who may see this video as well, because if we can begin to channel the information in and then be able to distribute it and get it out to people, then we can make better cases for our positions. But that's, again, that's the best I can do with... what time is it? 9:30, okay.
9:31. Any questions? Thank you, Brother Ben. Thank you.
Thank you, Brother. Thank you, sister.
Come back, you know.
Okay.
Talk and
I can go. I'll tell you what. I can give you my. I think I have a card.
Okay.
I'm a little tired. I started to.